Hey, Vlad here, devinsidey.com. Welcome to another video. In the previous video, we finally solved our issues related to the to-do IDs, and we did it with the tagless yet initial embedding, which is encoded with GADTs in a language like Scala. Today, we will talk about what it means to fold over them, and more importantly, when not to fold over them. Let's get right to it. Right, now before we get into the video, as a reminder, we still have a teeny bit of parallel error handling to do. That is like a leftover from a couple of videos ago that I really wish that I had done it the other time, but that video was getting way too long. Not this, this video is going to be very short. But in any case, we're still not gonna do it today. I wanted to make actually this video about error handling. I didn't want to make the video about folds just yet, but then I realized that the video about error handling can be made more general, and so it can, you know, even though it has a relation to Tagless Final and to this entire playlist, it can be made in such a way that it can reach more people. So this is going to be the next video, completely dedicated to error handling. It's not going to be part of this playlist, but it's totally related, so you should, you know, watch it before you watch the last video of this playlist. That said, I'm really having a hard time to find a slot where to insert this teeny bit of parallel error handling. And so we're going to do it today by the end of this video, even though it technically has no relation to folds. Well, a little bit it does, but you know, that's not what it's about. Anyway, was that out of the way? Let's begin this video. Now, if you have seen my video about the homegrown collections library, which you know, in which we created an entire homegrown collections library from scratch, if you remember, we started with sets. And then we implemented things like I don't know, map and flat map and fold, and we use recursion to all of them for all of them. And then we realized that actually all of them can be implemented in terms of fold. You know, then we moved on to lists, and then we realized that there is also directional folds like fold left and fold right. We're going to talk about them today a little bit as well, but they're not in the focus of this video. In any case, it turns out that all algebraic data types, all ADTs, and thus, you know, all of this, you know, initial embedding stuff, all of them are foldable. And so today we're going to have a conversation what it actually means to fold over an ADT. Or a GADT, a generalized algebraic data type, when we look at it as an you know, as an initially embedded tagless DSL. All right, so we're gonna go back to our to-do app and you know, and probably like in the second half of the video, but for now we're gonna start with an empty project as we always do, because we're just gonna play around. We're gonna use my typical jitterate template, and I'm gonna call it playground. Same as in the previous video, come dev inside. I removed the one from the previous video. Dev inside you, let's open it with Visual Studio Code, code playground like this. Let's let it go to full screen, and it still thinks that it's the previous one, which is why it opened it like this, like it tries to like remember, you know, the files that it opened from before. Yes, please import the changes. We're not gonna have any dependencies. However, we're gonna have relatively long lines today, so we're gonna go over here in the Scala FMG config. I'm just gonna say max column equals 120, and let's hope that it is going to fit. So we're gonna do B run. For now, let's just go and we're gonna have a scope over here, right? So we're just gonna have object scope like this. All right, and inside of it, we're going to have a bunch of ADTs, right? So then we just have like something to compare. In fact, as of right now, let's actually not even run it. Let's just compile. All right, so and this is how the ADT for option looks like. Sealed abstract class, option, you know, plus A extends product with serializable. Okay, so in the standard library, it's not, you know, the variants, the forms of the ADT are not defined in the companion object, but we're going to define them in the companion object. Final case class, some. Plus a extends option of a, man, I can't wait for scopes 3, case object none, extends option of nothing. Okay, a very simple GADT, and it has, you know, two forms. It can either be a sum, which, you know, traps an a inside of it, or it can be a none, and it needs to be covariant so that we can use nothing over here. All right, so the next one is going to be the one for the to-do IDs. And in fact, it actually looks so similar that we're gonna be able to just like copy paste it, okay? And I'm gonna save it. And I'm just gonna say like everywhere we say option, I'm just gonna say that this is going to be to-do. And everywhere where we say sum, I'm gonna say that this is going to be the existing one. And over here, none is going to be data. Why? Because the A is just a to-do ID, to-do ID, okay? So this one is called ID. This one is called data, which is data, okay? And the data is actually a final case class. Data, description, string, and a deadline, which is a local date, time. Right, not that it matters today, but still. All right, so they're very, very similar. Let's grab option again and have the one for either. Okay, so we're gonna call it either. Okay, either is gonna have the left side and the right side. So let's say that the A is going to be the right side. So we're gonna have a plus L over here, and this is going to be the right side, right side. Okay, and in fact, the way that I've written it down, like the right side is going to be over here. Okay, so this is going to be a final case class left that's going to have an L and an R, but it's going to use just the left one, and it's going to extend an either with L and R over here. This is going to be the right one. It still has both of them, L and R, but it uses only the right one. L comma R. Let's see if I made any typos over here. Two parameters. Okay, like this. This is an either. Let's also have one for lists. Maybe. Yeah, whatever. Okay. So option. This is gonna be list of A. This one is called cons, like this, and again it's inside of the companion object, but that's not the point. This is a nil, and it extends a list of nothing. So over here, this one is usually called head, and this one is called tail, which is going to be a list of A, right? So this is the first one that is recursive, but that doesn't really matter. And we're going to have also binary trees, right? Tree over here. So this one is usually called a branch, and this one is usually called a leaf. Okay, and so the branch has, it's not going to be called head, we're going to call it element, and usually it has like the left side and the right side. So let's say that this is going to be the right side, and let's say that this is going to be the left side, tree of A. Okay, like this, right? So now we have all of them, and they all look very, very similar. Option, to do, either, list, tree. Awesome. And now when you're dealing with them, like usually you pattern match, right? So usually like when you're dealing with one of these, like, so let's call them like top level types or something, usually you use pattern matching, right? So for example, over here, let's start with a simple one, option. So we're going to import option, right? So that we can, you know, access these guys. Okay. And let's say we wanted to implement exists, right? It's going to get some predicate that takes like a Boolean, and it's going to produce a Boolean. How's it going to implement it? Well, it's going to match, right? And if it's a sum, in fact, let's do the default case first, right? So if it's a none, then it's going to be false. And if it's a sum of A, well, then let's see what the predicate is going to say. Okay, very simple function, exists. Okay, we're just going to have like multiple ones, you know, so that we just have like a bit more examples. Okay, so this is going to be map, you know, A, B. I have no idea how many times I've implemented map on this channel. Option B, how's it going to do it? Pattern match. Okay, if it's a none, well, it's going to stay none. If it's a sum, well, then we're going to call f of a, like similar as we're calling the predicate, and then we're just going to wrap the whole thing into a sum, right? Because we need to produce an option. Let's do flat map. We can actually copy paste map and flat map because they're very, very similar. So this is going to be a flat map. This is going to be over here. The b is going to be an option. And because the f of a is going to produce an option, we don't need to wrap it again, right? That's it. Map and flat map. So they're all pattern matching, and it shouldn't come as a surprise if we define fold and an option. First of all, it also will just pattern match, and second of all of these will be able to be implemented in terms of fold. Okay, so let's do By the way, we could have made all of them final. Final default, it's going to produce some result, right? So this is what the, what this B is for, right? So there's always like some A, and you're always going to some B, you know, same as in map and platinum, okay? So yeah, so we have the B, and we're going to have like, you know, if it's a none, and then we're going to produce a B, it's a by name parameter, right? So this is like sort of the default, and usually it's called seed. And if it's a sum, then it's just going to go from A to B, B. And the implementation, as always, match. If it's a none, well, then we're going to give, you know, give the default. And if it's a sum, then we're going to give if sum, and we're going to give the A, right? Super, super simple. You know, in the standard library, like usually this is called seed. But for now, let's just leave it like this, right? So it's just like, if none, if some, and then, you know, if it has parameters, then it needs to be a function that can deal with this parameter, okay? Super simple. So let's implement, for example, flat map, right? So I'm gonna do, like flat map two, right? So I'm gonna say fold, and if it's a none, then what are we gonna do? Well, we're gonna do none. And if it's a sum, then we're just gonna pass in the function. It's probably confused because of the parameters. It's confused because of this none. So usually when you're dealing with folds, you want to be explicit about like what you are returning. Okay, so like this, and now we can like remove these guys, like this none, and over here just f, like this. Let's throw the other one out, right, like this. Okay, so this one, you know, this is the map, so we're gonna do same thing, you know, fold. Let's help it out right away. Option B, it's gonna be none, otherwise it's gonna be a function that's gonna take an A. It's gonna do this now, same as before, right? We needed to wrap it in a sum. Okay, and exists fold. In this particular case, we don't need to help it out and say, hey, you know, please return a boolean. Scala will be able to infer this one for us. And again, like if it's a none, then it's going to be a false, and if it's a sum, then it's just going to be the predicate, like this, all of them, super nice, false. So we're going to throw these ones out, right? But what we're going to do is we're going to go and define false for all of the others. Okay, so I'm just going to like copy that. And I'm going to go over here and I'm going to paste it over here like this. All right. So, okay. So our cases aren't going to be called if none, if some. So our cases are going to be called, you know, if existing, and this one is going to be called if data. All right. And so over here, like this is going to be existing of ID and data. And this is going to be data of description and deadline, okay? And therefore, these functions should be able to take them in, okay? So this is the one that takes the to-do ID and data. So exactly what we have over here, and somehow managed to produce a D. And this one, you know, it's going to take the string and the local date time over here, right? String and the local date time, and somehow it will manage to produce a B. Right. And so we can call them over here was the ID and data. It's all boilerplate. And one day we're going to talk about recursion schemes, and we're going to see that some of it can be generated for us with some awesome libraries. All right. So we're importing option not to do like this. And there we go. Okay. So let's go and what I still have in paste. Okay. I have this. So let's go here, copy that. Let's go into the other. Okay, like this. Let's import other as well. Import other like this. Okay, so what do we have? We have basically if left and if right. This is the if left. This is the if right. Okay, so this is going to be a left of L. It's going to be a right of R. And we're going to say if left, I give it the L. If right, give it the R, which means that this can be a function that goes from L to B. This is the function that goes from R to B. There we go. Super simple. All right. Now the lists are going to be a little bit different because they have directions. So we're going to have fold left and fold right. However, please don't concentrate on the fold left and fold right. This is not what this video is about. We're just going to like type them out real quick, and that's all. Okay. So, okay. First of all, let's import list. And this one is going to be a fold left. So we're going to have if nil, then, you know, similar to an option, like somehow you're going to magically magically just produce a B for us, right? So if this is a nil, okay, it's nil like this. In fact, let's do it like this in this case, okay? And in this particular case, so if this is a head and tail, right? So if this is a head and tail, then we're gonna have a function over here, which is gonna be if const, the one that is going to, and this is the interesting one, okay? So this is going to have the result of the previous computation, the B, right? And the current element. And then somehow it will manage to produce the result. Okay, this is sort of like the trick of folds. Like this is the, you know, the recursion one, the recursive ones, and this is the trick, right? So if you need something like from before, because like before what we did was, we always looked at, I don't know, for example, this one, right? So we looked at the form and we just grabbed the types and put them into the function, right? Over here, if we were to do the same, we would grab like an A and a list of A, right? And we're sort of doing this, but instead of the list of A, we're putting the result of the list of A, right? If you've seen my homegrown collection series, then it should be clear what is happening over here. Okay, so this is going to be called, you know, if const, and it's going to get the if nil and the head. Okay, but now it's recursive. Okay, so what we have right now is just the result of the head, and what we also need to do is we need to grab the result of the rest. Okay, so we need to grab the tail, and we need to call fold left recursively, right? And we're going to give the head result, which starts to look a little bit monadic, by the way. You know, that we have like this result that is like being threaded through the rest of the computation, and the function is going to stay the same. Okay. And now we're done. We can just return the result. Okay. So this is fold left, and, you know, fold left is the one that can be implemented, in the tail recursive way. But again, this video is not about, you know, these things. So, we're just going to go and do the, you know, the fold left and the, we're gonna do the fold right. And by the way, like for this particular one, I'm actually gonna call it seed, right? And we're just gonna call this one F, so that it looks like a little bit more familiar, because this one is like the slightly more more complicated one. Okay, so we're also gonna do the fold right, final def fold right. It's the same deal. In fact, I'm gonna copy this line, okay? Fold right, and it's sort of like a convention to swap these guys, right? So there's going to be A first and then B, okay? So the implementation is going to be very similar. So we're going to do match, and if it's a nil, then we're just going to return the seed, right? And if it's a head and tail, then the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to compute the tail result, right? We're going to do tail.foldRight seed and F. And by the way, in just a second, I'm going to remind you why a fold left can be made tail recursive and fold right cannot be in a general case. Then we're just going to call the F with the head and the tail result. Okay, and then we're going to return the result. Okay, so yeah, so as a reminder, fold left and fold right, you know, the way they work is they both traverse the list from left to right. However, fold left applies the function as it moves along, and therefore it never needs to go back. Right, and so it has a recursion in the tail position because it never has to go back, and therefore you can implement it as a loop, or you know, it can be optimized away the compiler. And you see it clearly over here, right? So you can do the result, you know, even like, you know, like if you return the head result over here, right? The implementation is going to be wrong, right? But at least like you don't need to like keep going, right? You can already calculate something, okay? So if this was like a list was only one element, right? So then this function would return immediately, right? Result like this, okay? On the other hand, fold right, it also goes from left to right. However, first it goes through the entire list until the very end, and then on the way back, it applies the function, right? So it dug itself into this like tail result, tail result, tail result. Now it comes back and it actually starts to apply the function, which means that it needs to allocate memory, right? So as it moves along, it needs to keep track of everything that it has seen so far, sort of like backtracking, right? And then like when it goes back, and then it actually applies this thing. So you need some sort of stack, you need some sort of memory, okay? In fact, in the standard library, the way fold right is actually implemented on things like lists is by reversing the list and then calling fold left. Okay, but again, like this video is absolutely not about fold left and fold right. It's in general about folding. Okay, so the one that is left to do is the tree, and it's going to be very similar to this. In fact, maybe we can actually steal it, go over here and paste it over here. And when we say a list, we're going to say tree, Okay, so default left is going to be, so if it's a leaf, right, leaf over here, then it's gonna remain as a seed, okay? Now, if it's a, it's not gonna be head and tail, instead it's gonna be a branch with the, you know, left element and right. And we did this in the homegrown collection series, by the way, okay? Then this is going to be called current result. And this one, let's say that this is going to be the right one. You can go in any direction you want, but this is going to be the right result because we're going to go into the right, tail, so to say. Okay. And so, hold on, current result. Okay. And then we need to go also into the left one. You know, we need to have the left result, left for left, right result was an F. And then we're going to return the left result. Okay, and at the bottom over here, same pattern match, like this, and like that. This is going to be called current result. This is going to be called right. I think let's go left, just because, you know, because it's going to compile anyway, so we don't really care. So this is going to be, in fact, this is going to be the hold on. So this is going to be the right result, and this is going to be the right result. However, before we obtain it, we're going to get the left result, and the left result is going to go and do left. This one was already the left one. Yeah, this one was already the left one. Okay, so this is the left one. This is the left result. This is going to be the right result. Confused myself. Right, I know, fold right. We always need to, like, take the result from the previous one, which is the left result, and we're going to get the F. And over here, this is going to be the one with the right result, result. Okay, it's not called head, it's called element. And same thing over here, element. And there we go, everything compiles. So we have this whole thing. I'm not even going to push this thing, right? This is the stuff that we did, like, so many times in the homegrown collection series, and this video is also not, like, super about, like, fold left and fold right. And also, I just wanted to show you, like, a couple of recursive ones, right? Because for the simple ones, you know, for the non-recursive ones, it's simple, right? You just copy the data, you basically copy the constructors into the functions, right? So, for example, over here, it just wants the L, so you're going to have a function from L to B. Over here, you have a function that, you know, constructor wants to do ID and data. So you have a function that goes to do ID and data to B, okay? But for the recursive ones, it's a bit more tricky. And so I did it. Now, again, I know that this was very fast, but this video is not, like, super focused on folds. It is more focused on what it means to fold on a GADT when you look at it as a tagless initial embedding. Okay, so remember in the video part 4.2, I believe, where I basically said that, you know, like, most teams have much bigger problems than, you know, rewriting their entire code base into the tagless final style. However, what you can do, like, on the way there is basically by not using pattern matching, instead using, like, things like map and flat maps and folds. And so what we're going to do now is we're going to go to the to our to-do app, and we're going to replace pretty much all the pattern matchings that we can find with the folds. And I said that if you do this, then it's going to be easier to go from an option to an either, and from an either to a validated, or from, you know, from either to I don't know, to applicative error or something. So what we're going to do is we're going to go to the to-do app now, and we're going to replace all of them. However, we're going to stumble on a couple of the interesting ones, the ones that will actually cause us to redesign more things. And so we're going to see that, you know, with these others and with the options, somehow it's going to save us code, but with this other ones, it's going to create more problems, and we're going to have a conversation about why this happened. All right, so let's go over here. So this is the to-do app from the previous video, the status from the previous video. So I'm just going to go and try to find case dot star arrow to the right, and I'm going to enable the pattern match, you know, regular expression search over here. Okay, so it's going to find all of the pattern matches, and Visual Studio Code allows me to exclude a couple of things from this pattern match. Like, for example, this one, this is just the menu, so we're not interested in this one. Also, this one is inside of SBT, so we don't care about this one. We don't care about this one, right? So this is the menu. Okay, menu. Okay, so these are the ones that we're interested in. So we're gonna come back to them. This is the same one, right? So these are the routes. This is an either. Yeah, we're gonna go back to this one. We're gonna implement a fold for the updates. These ones are the ones that we need. These are also the ones that we need, you know, where we're pattern matching on the to-do. Same thing over here. These ones we don't care about, these ones we don't care about, these ones we don't care about, these ones we don't care about. Okay, so these are the few that we're going to go through and improve. Let's just click on the first one over here. Okay, so we're basically trying to figure out, hold on, is it going to disappear? Yeah, awesome. Okay, so if the sidebar disappears, then I'm not having the markings, but if I make it reappear again, then our search is still there, which is great. Okay, so basically over here where we can use a fold. Okay, so instead of this whole thing, we're gonna have like basically one line, right? So this is our either, right? And we're just gonna do either fold, right? And if it's a left side, then we're just gonna do console.put error LM, right? So this thing. And if it's the right side, then we're just gonna do on success, right? So this thing, you know, this one tiny fold is exactly, you know, the same thing, but now it can be just one line, right? So if I can do like an underscore over here and maybe press enter over here, then it's gonna look like this, right? So it's much, much shorter. And now it's easier to go from something like an option, you know, even though like an option has like a current version over here. But still, like if you're going like from validated to an either, this thing is still gonna compile, okay? So let me remove this, let me open that. So it disappeared now. So let's go over here. Same deal, duplicate this line over here. We're just gonna do underscore at fold. On the left side, we're gonna have this. On the right side, we're gonna have invalid. Throw this out. In this particular case, it even fits into one line. Sorry, invalid ID. All right, let's go to the other one. Is it actually better to have it like this, or is it better to have it like that? Oh, Scala FMD does not even give me a choice. All right, so let's go to the next one, which is this one. Okay, so this is an option. So in this particular case, you know, it's gonna be curried, right? So we're gonna have like this fold and like this, right? So this is gonna be this one, and this is gonna be this one, unfound, like this. All right, so we can throw this out like that. All right, and this one. Okay, so we're already in the next controller. Okay, so let me duplicate this one. And okay, so oh, this one is an interesting one, right? So we can do like fold, and the left hand side is going to be bad request, and unfortunately you have to do this. The right side is going to be this, right? And because this is a pipe, we can actually just put the local thing over here. Just do that and just do that. And like this, nice and cute, right? The next one is going to be, okay, we're gonna leave the updates for a bit, the right ones. Okay, so this is the same trick. So let's do just two ID, we pass it the ID. It's gonna give us an either so we can fold. On the left side, we're gonna just do a bad request, and on the right hand side, we're just gonna do invalid ID, right? It's not only is it shorter, but it's also like more sort of like future proof, right? So if you move from either to obligative error or something, okay? What's left? This one. All right, so this is the one with the option. So we're gonna have a flat map. Inside of the flat map, we're gonna have the fold, which is curried. So on the left side, we're gonna do this. On the right side, we're gonna do that, and that's it. Okay, so we have less code. All right, so the only things that are left are the ones that was the to-dos, and these are the ones that are gonna cause us some issues. And the only one that is left is this pattern match on the controller on the updates. Okay, so we're gonna go over here. So we're basically trying to figure out, are we only updating the description, or are we updating the deadline, or are we updating all the fields? And so what we're gonna do now is we're gonna go down to the update and we're gonna implement the default. So let's jump into the update over here, and we're gonna do basically the same thing as we were doing in this background thing. Okay, so we're gonna do import update, and we're gonna do over here, we're gonna do a final default. Gonna produce some B somehow. In this particular case, we have like three cases. So I'm gonna have if description, right? Which is gonna be a function that's gonna take string to B, right? So it's gonna take this string to B. Then we're gonna have if deadline string to B, right? This deadline, okay? And then over here, we're gonna have if alt fields, which is gonna take string, string, and B. Alt fields is description and deadline, right? So alt fields just points to create, which is over here, description deadline, okay? Not a big deal, okay? And then somehow we're gonna produce a B, and big surprise, how we're gonna do this, we're gonna pattern match this match, okay? Case, if it's a description with a D, then we're gonna say if description with a D, if it's a deadline with a D, then we're gonna do if deadline with a D, and if it's all fields, which might not compile as of right now, with a description and, okay, DD, okay. So let's do description and deadline. Then we're gonna do if all fields, description and description and deadline. Okay, so in this particular case, I prefer to call this one description as well. Description, description, deadline, deadline, and this line gets kind of long. So let's do this, let's do that, and let's do that. And this probably is not gonna compile. Constructor cannot be description. This is oh, did I put in the object? Why did I put in the object? Hold up, like this, and it should be over here, like that. All right, yeah. All fields doesn't compile because we have only the type, so we're just gonna do, I don't know, val all fields equals create. Like that. All right. Okay, so what do we need? We need to go now and use it, right? So this is the fold that we're going to use it. Where was it? It was over here. In this particular case, it's kind of weird because we're using it only once. So implemented, you know, implementing fold just for this one is kind of, it's kind of weird. Okay, so let me do that. Like this, because it's just going to be a fold of update description, right? So basically all of these, update description, update deadline, and update alt fields, but they also need the IDs, right? So we're going to pass in the IDs, and we're going to make it curried so that the payload is being passed over here like this. All right, nice and easy. So this should compile now if I save the file, but these ones are not going to compile. Oh, I forgot the commas. Oh, what the hell happened here? Like this, comma and comma. Okay, so now we need to make sure that when we're updating the description, that why is it still a string actually? Why is ID a string? Oh yeah, because it's been parsed lower. All right. So anyway, we just need to curry them. Curry them like this, and now it's not going to have the payload, it's just going to have the description, which is going to be a string. And so over here we're just going to have like this. All right, so the first one already compiles. Same deal over here, like that, like that. This is going to be the deadline, which is going to be a string, which is going to be here, deadline. Okay, the last one is this, so it's going to get the ID, and it's going to get the description, which is a string, and the deadline, which is a string, and where it says payload dot, in these two cases, just do that, and that should be it, it should compile, right? So yeah, it's a simple fold now. Maybe it's even going to fit into one line. Yeah, it fits into one line. I can never decide if it's better to have it in one line or not. Maybe this one, will this one fit? Even this one fits, right? So because we're using a fold, it's now a teeny tiny function. It's just that these ones are kind of bigger, so they're abstracted away. They are curried now. In any case, let's get to the final, you know, to the meat of this video, which is let's go and try to do the same thing for the to-dos, right? Because the to-dos are the only ones that are now left. Okay. What the hell happened here? In any case, so in-memory entity gateway and Postgres entity gateway are the only ones that are doing this. Okay, so I'm going to go to the to-do Hold on, let me make sure that this file stays. I'm gonna go to do, okay? I'm gonna go to the previous project over here where we already had the fold on the to do, and I'm just gonna grab it like that. This is the to do, and let's put above like over here, okay, like this. All right, great. Okay, so now we have the fold on our to-dos, but now something weird is going to happen. We're gonna go and try use it, but it's actually gonna cause us more problems. And in fact, what I'm gonna do now, I'm actually gonna go to my terminal over here, and I'm gonna cd into the Tagless Final thing, and I'm actually going to just commit. So I'm using ZSH, and one of the ZSH aliases is GWP. If you have the Git plugin, which comes bundled with all my ZSH, and GWP just commits everything, right? So it just like creates this commit where it just like dumps everything in there. Okay, because what we're going to do now is we're going to try to use this this fold, and it's going to cause us some issues, and then we're going to revert it. Right. So if we go into the in-memory entity gateway, right? So what it does over here is the same thing as always, right? Just pattern matches, and then it calls a function. However, these functions, they're written in such a way that they're not taking the insides of the data, right? So inside of the data, there is a description deadline. However, this function actually wants the specific form of this ADT. In fact, in the previous video, I told you that it is good, you know, to have access to this type. Okay, and so if we were to try to use a fold over here, it's not going to compile, right? So we could like, you know, to do is like traverse, right? And inside of it, we're going to do fold, and then I don't remember which one came first. Existing came first. Okay, so this one came first, right? So we should be able to do something like this, and over here we should be able to do something like this, right? And if you wanted to make this work, we would need to go into the statement, and we would need to go and okay, so insert one, for example, it says like, hey, I want the data, okay? And so we would need to go and grab the description instead, right? So the insides of the data, description and deadline, which is gonna be a local date time, which we probably don't even have here. Yes, so please import it for us. Let's put it above, not that it matters because we're going to revert this whole thing anyway. So this is going to be the insert one, and the update one is going to be similar, right? So it's going to have the ID, right, which is going to be the integer, and then it's going to have the data, which is going to be to do dot data, like this. Okay, so let me grab these guys, insert one, and put them over here, right? Like this. Okay, so now we don't have the data, so we need to construct it ourselves to do that, you know, data with description and deadline, like this. And with the update one, let's grab the ones ID data. Here. Update one. Okay, so we have the ID and we have the data. Now what we need to do over here, okay, we're using the to do twice. We need to sort of like bring it back. And in fact, this is going to be the point of the whole conversation, right? Like this. Okay, so now we're bringing it back. We still have problems somewhere. Divergent implicit. Really, what's your problem? Too many arguments for method fold. Is it curried? Oh, because I copy pasted it from option, I made all of them curried. I don't want it to be curried. I want it to be like this. Okay. Yeah. Let's go and fix it over here as well. Yeah. So over here, I didn't, because you know we started with option, and so all the copy paste was curried, right? So usually, like with the either, it's not curried. These ones are curried. Yeah, okay, so the other and the to do, they're not curried for some reason. In any case, so over here, right? So this part now compiles. Over here, everything compiles now. Like we fixed everything. Everything works again, right? The whole code base compiles. But for some reason, it was, you know, we needed to change a lot of code. And so we need to have a conversation what actually happened here. So let's have a look what happened. So over here, we're calling fold, and sort of like the purpose of the fold is to hide the internal structure so that you don't have to pattern match on it, right? So you just pass in these functions and they will deal with it. However, once we go inside, not into the declaration, but into the implementation, there was something weird that was happening, right? So in both of them. So for example, over here, we're having the insides of data, but for some reason, we couldn't avoid reconstructing the data. Right, so it feels like we went like inside and out, right? And the same thing over here, we're passing the insides of to-do existing, but somehow we ended up reconstructing the to-do existing. In fact, we needed it, you know, multiple times over here for some reasons. Well, in fact, for this one, we didn't, right? We could have used the ID, but that's not the point. Okay, so there is something weird, like we tried to use fold to avoid knowing the internal structure, but somehow we ended up reconstructing the internal structure. And that's actually not the biggest problem. The biggest problem is that somehow we're creating a structure and destroying it again. This is not what fold is usually for. So what I'm talking about is that there is something bigger there. And we need to remember the very, very first videos in this Tagless Final playlist, where I said, you know, when we started was the initial embedding, right? Because every ADT, right, every GADT especially, can be pretty much viewed as a tagless initial embedding, right? And if you remember the interpretation, right, the denotational semantics, like what does it mean to interpret this thing in our host language? What does it mean was, you know, the interpreter, it was a pattern match. And therefore, it was the fold, right? The fold is pretty much isomorphic to a pattern match. And the thing is that when we're finding ourselves in this, like, you know, purely functional, referentially transparent buzzword world, then interpreting something is usually something that needs to be happen in the end, because you want to stay in this land of Oz, right, as long as you can, right, before you sort of explode the whole thing and you lose this whole structure. You want to stay and manipulate and map and flat map, and only in the end you want to interpret. So what happened here is that we tried to fold too early, right? We tried to fold, but we actually didn't want to lose like all of the structure. And so we ended up recreating it, right? So the others, you know, the controllers where we had like others and options, they happened pretty much at the end, right? At the end of the request cycle, you know, at the end of the response cycle, basically at the very end, you know, if it's something there, then, you know, then it's good. If not, then, you know, display an error, right? But over here, we actually needed to recreate it. And why did we need to recreate it? Well, we needed to recreate it because in this one, it's actually not super, super visible. Why? In the other one, it is, well, it's a little bit visible, right? Because over here, we needed to be very precise about which form we're returning, okay? To do existing, right? We're not just returning to do. If we were just returning to do, we wouldn't care about recreating the form. But over here, we needed one specific form. Also, in the Postgres one over here, it's the same trick, right? It's the same pattern match, and therefore it could have been a fold. However, then it calls like insert one and update one, which are just private defs over here, and they go and they're preparing an insert statement, right, over here, and the update one prepares an update statement. Okay, and so we could have made sure that they over here, as always, it jumped into the wrong one. I'm not sure why. Statement, Postgres, over here. So let's do like insert, right? We could have made sure that somehow this query works with to-do, right? And then we would have ended up, you know, folding over here. Like this would have been like the proper way, right? But still, like even here, we would have folded, and then we would be forced to recreate only one of the forms, right? So we would destroy everything, and then we would come back, okay? And yeah, so this is pretty much what I wanted to make this video about. And one day we're gonna have a video about recursion schemes, and we're gonna learn that fold, which is like interpretation, which is like destroying of this container, right? So to say, in categorism, like all of these like transformations, they're called morphisms, and all of the names in category theory, they come from Greek. And this particular morphism is called a catamorphism, C-A-T-A, which is one of the most awesome morphisms because obviously it includes the word cat. Anyway, catamorphism, you know, the word kata, it comes from Greek, and so there's no need to be afraid of things like this. In Greek, kata means, you know, downwards or something destructive, and there are examples like, you know, cataclysm, or catabolic, or even similarly unrelated words like catalog, right? A bunch of things in English are coming from Greek, right? So the point is, don't be afraid of these words. They're just, you know, they're just words. They're coming from, in this case, from Greek. They have a meaning. Look up the meaning. You know, there's nothing super fancy about them. And oftentimes, they're not even some fancy mathematical words from Greek. They are sometimes even names of some mathematicians. Like, for example, the Classley arrows. You know, they're just called after Heinrich Classley, who was a Swiss mathematician, who was working on the Classley arrows or Classley functions. And yeah, so let's revert this nonsense real quick. Let's go over here. Where's my console? So another alias is GRHH, which is git reset hard. So let's just do git reset hard, okay? And another alias is also G unwhip. So by the way, GWIP stands for git work in progress, right? And G unwhip is like, you know, basically undo it, right? So it's gonna find the commit that contains the work in progress, which is, you know, which is this one, and it's going to undo it, right? It's not gonna remove the changes. It's just gonna remove the commit from the history, right? So it's not there. So now, like, all of the changes that we did before are here, which are the changes where we basically, so I'm gonna leave default even though we're not gonna use it, but basically, like, all of these, like, where we went from a pattern match to a fold, okay? And over here, the same thing, we went from a pattern match to a fold. We created the fold for the update, and what else did we do? Yeah, so this is a fold for the update, and so this is pretty much it for this part. And as a reminder, like in the beginning, I told you that we still need to do this, like, parallel error handling. So we're gonna do this now real quick, even though it technically doesn't have a super relationship to folds, but in fact, it's actually going to use a fold just a little bit. So let's actually commit this part real quick. So it's gonna be gcam video. All right, so it's gonna be video 16 part 14, and I'm gonna do like folds, fold, okay, fold, and this parallel validation thing that we're gonna do, it's gonna be another commit for the same part, okay? So let's go over here, let's do this, like that, let's close all of them. All right, so we need to go into the controller for the HTTP CRUD, this one. Okay, so we had this update, right? So we have update description, we have update deadline, and we have update all fields in which we have the opportunity to handle two validation errors, right? Technically parsing errors, you know, as we learned in the previous video, right? It's before it, then it's parsing, right? So there is a chance that, you know, both the, well, for the description, there is no chance, but like for the ID, there is a chance that the ID is wrong, and there is a chance that the deadline is wrong, right? And we are parsing them sequentially, right? So if the ID is wrong, the only error message that the user is going to see is that the ID was wrong, even though the deadline might have been wrong as well, right? Maybe it didn't match the pattern. And so we only have this issue, we only have this opportunity to do this because we have, you know, we're dealing with HTTP, and both things can come in at the same time. Remember, like in the regular terminal application, you know, we're asking for the ID first, and then we have a chance to validate it and say, hey, the ID was wrong before we even ask for the deadline. We could have also waited and had some like internal state, you know, where we would ask for the deadline as well and then validate them both together. But on the terminal, you know, if you're entering things one by one, then why bother? However, over here, this is actually a valid case. Okay. Now, if you remember, with ID prompt inside of it, it has a fold, and if I go back and I go to with deadline prompt inside of it, it also has a fold, okay? But what's happening inside is pretty much the happy path, okay? So let's for now just like cut it out and say that this is going to be our happy path, right? So the happy path, well, it's going to get the description, and we're going to have a separate parameter list for all of the things that were parsed, which is the ID and the deadline, okay? So over here, we're going to have a private def happy path, and it's going to have some parameters, and it's going to do like all of this stuff. All right, so the happy pass is just going to have the, it's going to have the description, which is going to be a string. It's going to have a second parameter list, which is going to be the to-do ID, right? So it's a happy pass, which means it managed to parse them, right? So over here, there were strings. ID was a string. Deadline was a string. Over here, ID is a to-do ID, and deadline is a local date time. And this is why the parameter lists are separated, because over here, like, nothing happened, okay? And the whole thing is going to produce an F of response of F. Okay, so as of right now, like, this is just a refactoring, and probably doesn't want private because we're like in a lower scope. So that's fine. Okay, so private def. Okay, what's your issue? What do you not like? Illegal start of statement. No modifiers allowed here. So this means that something is wrong with the curly brace. We have this one. We have the second one. Where is this one coming from? Like this. And which means over here, like, it should have been here. Yeah, there we go. Scala FMT woke up, everything's fine now. Okay, so this is the happy path, and we're just calling the happy path. So all we need to do is we need to change the things around the happy path. Okay, so if we go inside the with ID prompt, what it does is it calls to ID. So we just need to grab the to ID, go back, and instead over here, basically do it manually, right? So we're gonna do what with ID prompt was doing for us. Okay, same thing with deadline prompt. It was doing, you know, this. So we need to go back, and we need to do it over here. We're just gonna stick them into a tuple. Okay, so they both return either's of, you know, either string, which is an error, or that thing that they're returning. Like, this one will return a to-do ID. This one will actually return a local date. However, what we need them to do is we need to convert them to lists of strings, right? Because we want to concatenate them, we don't want to just smash strings together. Okay, there's a helper function like this to either neck. Okay, so now the left side, which used to be strings, it's now an unempty chain of strings. Okay, so now we have both of them, and so what we need to do is we need to say not just tupled, right? Because if we tupled them, this is an either, and either fails fast with the first error. We need to do part tupled. Okay, so now this thing is a tuple, right? Well, actually, we can see it. Yeah, it should, because like this part is still there, so our code is still gonna compile. So now I can just show you like what this part tupled is. There we go. So this is an either neck of string. So it's either a bunch of strings with the errors, or it's a tuple with a to-do ID and local date time. What are we gonna do? We're going to call fold, right? It's an either, right? So we can call fold on it, okay? And we just learned about the faults. On the left, we're going to deal with the errors, right? So this is going to be the underscore, which is going to be a non-empty chain of strings. We're just going to put them all into JSON, pipe them into bed request. Okay. And on the right side, okay, remember, we're dealing with a tuple. Okay. So we're going to have a case, you know, this is ID and this is the deadline. Okay. Right. In this case, we're just going to call the happy path like this. Right? Was the description, was the ID and deadline. Okay? So right now it should compile, and it does. And right now we can also remove these guys. Right? And the reason why I queried this function is because I knew that it's going to end up like this. As ID deadline over here, ID deadline over here. The only difference is that over here it's a tuple, and over here it's not. And so we can use a function called tuple. Right? So we can function.tupled. Right, and now we can just pass in happy path with description, which is much shorter than this line. Okay, but it does exactly the same thing. Okay, like this, and there we go. This is pretty much it. So this is the parallel error validation and stuff. So we're gonna go into main HTTP. Whatever. Let's do this one. Restart. Let's go into client.http. Okay, so let's see, let's do show all so that it even works. There we go. Okay, so let's find the one. Do we even have one? So we need an update for both of them. Okay, we have deletes, we have search, update all fields. Okay, in this one. Okay, so this is the one that would work if we actually, grab this guy over here, update all fields, right? So we have buy milk and the date is gonna change. So if we send it, it should be fine, right? It's over there, it's all good. So if we do show all, it's all good. Okay, and now if we do update all fields, parallel error handling like this, okay, and then let's break the ID, right? So this is going to be blah, and let's break something in the deadline like this, okay? Then let's create a little bit more space, let's send this request, and there we go. This is our JSON array with both of the errors in value UID string blah, and this one does not match the required format. Super, super awesome. All right, so that's good. Let me check it out real quick. So too much stuff. This one. Okay, seems fine. So if we go back, let's do it again. So this is going to be part 14, but this is going to be parallel error handling like this. Let's push the whole thing. Let's go to my other workspace. Let's go here. Let's refresh the page. So over here, let's go look at this one. Let's look at the fault first, because it happened just now and it's super tiny, right? So I changed the client.http, but over here, not much change. We refactored this part into happy path. And then instead of like using these helpers, we basically created a new one on the fly. Okay. This one was defaults. We added defaults. We already went through this, right? Yeah. Nice. So we're pretty much done with the series. We're going to have one more video about error handling, which is going to be very, very awesome. In the beginning, I wasn't super sure if I should make it or not, but then I realized that there are actually some really, really necessary things. And in fact, we have a couple of bugs in our application. And we're actually going to discover those bugs in the video after that, which is going to be the video about testing. Okay, so the next video about error handling is going to be technically outside of this Tagless Final playlist, so that it can reach more audience. But it is totally related to Tagless Final. It's going to be specific. It's going to be called something like error handling for Tagless Final, right? And yeah, so pretty much there's going to be only two videos left, unless they end up being too long, and then I'm going to split them into two. But yeah, that's pretty much it. And so for now, it's been Vlad, deminsideyou.com. Don't forget to like this video if you did, subscribe if you want to improve the developer inside you, and if you learned something today, consider supporting me on Patreon or on GitHub sponsors, whatever you prefer, and thus watch my videos weeks and sometimes even months before everyone else. But most importantly, take care.